All right, so the fish fauna of the basin is actually really low in species richness, but despite that, it's really diverse. So there's fishes of a wide range of sizes, a wide range of habitat associations, reproductive traits, and scales of life history. And so this really presents a lot of issues for management. So each of these species or different groups are likely to interact with their environment and flow in different ways. So we have to consider individual species or groups of species biology. Now, one group of fish that has really unique life histories may not be completely familiar with a lot of people in this room, are the diadromous fishes, and those are guys that have to move between fresh and saltwater environments to complete their life cycle. In the basin, there are two forms of anadromy represented. Anadromy, which is typified by the salmonids from the northern hemisphere. So predominant adult residences in the ocean, migration upstream to spawn. The other form is catadromy, which is characterised by adult freshwater residents and downstream migration for marine spawning. Now, given that these guys have to undertake these migrations, it's critical for their life history. They are probably the most vulnerable species to obstruction of migration by flow regulating structures. And indeed, in the modern river, they're highly dependent on flow to stimulate migrations and facilitate connectivity for these movements. So in the basin, there's been eight species recorded in the past, six of which were formerly common. They're mostly catadromous, with the exception of short-headed lamprey and pouch lamprey, which are anadromous. And today I'm really going to talk about two fish that we've done most research on in the last decade or so, the congolli up the top and pouch lamprey down the bottom here. And I'll speak about them because they represent the opposite forms of diadromy. They've got different scales of life history. And through our research, we've really found out ways in which we think that flow can be delivered and infrastructure managed to support their migration and populations. So without going too further, I need to put some spatial and hydrological context into my talk. And we're right down the bottom of the basin now, in the Lower Lakes and Coorong. And what's unique about this area is that a series of tidal barrages were constructed many years ago that now separate the Lower Lakes and Lower River from the Coorong Estuary in the Southern Ocean. The barrages are quite low. They're only about 1 to 2 metres high, but they're really extensive. They're over 7 kilometres in length. And they represent the primary barrier to diadromous fishes either moving in and out of the basin. Fortunately now, there's fishways on every single one of these structures, at least one, that facilitate upstream migration. But downstream migration of fishes is really only facilitated when there's water being discharged and gates are open on the barrage. This is hydrology we've experienced over the last 10 years. As you can see, it's been really variable. Again, the millennium drought's been spoken about already. It's probably the most notable thing. So from 2007 to 2010, not a drop of fresh water entered the Coorong. The barrages were completely shut. There was no connectivity whatsoever. Since then, we've had a few floods and a few lower flow years as well. What's important to note is that the barrages don't necessarily, or discharge at the barrages doesn't necessarily reflect discharge upstream. This red line represents discharge at Lock 1, the next regulating structure upstream. And you can see there's several periods, including the millennium drought and even more recently, where there's flow at Lock 1, but the barrages again are completely shut. So just to sort of briefly describe our research, a lot of what we've done is monitor migration by monitoring fishways with these large cage traps, and also monitoring sites immediately below the barrages. So we've done this since 2006, typically in spring and summer, but also during winter. And it's been great in informing us on the timing of migration of these diadromous fishes and also their abundances. Additionally, we've been able to take several specific movement studies. So that's included a study looking at the movement of adult female congolli in 2009-2010, and a couple of projects looking at lamprey movement in 2015 using pit tags, and one that we're undertaking right now using acoustic telemetry. So I'll just briefly run through this research, going through each individual species. So onto the first guy, congolli. These guys are a medium-bodied catadromous fish, so adult females grow to around about 350 mils in length. They've got a really interesting life history. So the females tend to live in freshwater habitats. The males, which are a bit smaller, tend to be more common in the estuary. And the females, at about 4 years of age, they migrate downstream through the estuary and into the ocean for spawning, and the males presumably undertake a similar migration. So spawning occurs out there, and eggs and larvae float around for a bit, juveniles at around 90 days of age move into the estuary and migrate upstream into freshwater habitats. Now, despite moving into freshwater habitats, they don't move too far upstream, so we rarely get these guys above lock one, and really the population is focused on probably the bottom 200 kilometres of the basin. Now, this plot here represents the abundance of these upstream migrating juveniles here at a fishway on Tewitchery Barrage since 2006. And as you can see, abundance has been highly variable. And perhaps most notably is 2007 to 2010, when these young of year were pretty much absent. Again, if we go back to the hydrograph that we saw before, it coincides with the period of the millennium drought and loss of connectivity between freshwater and estuarine habitats. And then if we move forward to our acoustic telemetry work, this really starts to show the mechanisms behind some of these declines in abundance of young of year. So 2009, 2010, we were able to tag about 30 or so adult female congolli in freshwater habitats. In both years, movements were really similar. About 70% of fish migrated downstream in winter, coincided with low temperature and decreasing photo period. However, both years were different in regards to freshwater flow and whether the barrages were open or not, and this really dictated where their migration ended. So in 2009, the barrages were completely shut. These females migrated downstream, banged their heads against the wall, accumulated, were either eaten by cormorants or basically were stuck there for the rest of the year. But in 2010, the drought broke halfway through the migration season, and the fish that migrated downstream in that year were able to pass through the barrage, straight through the estuary, and they made it to spawning habitats in the ocean. Now, this is the same plot as before, the juvenile abundance plot, but I've actually overlaid this line, which is the proportion of days in the previous winter where there was connectivity between freshwater and estuarine environments. And there was a really small but significant increase in abundance immediately after that year when the fish could finally get through. And then abundance slowly increased, but consistently every year. It was probably a result of gradually increasing adult populations following 3 years of actually 100% connectivity. But interestingly, the last couple of years, abundance has actually declined, and this appears to be in association with, again, decreasing connectivity during winter. So to quickly summarise for this species, it's actually quite simple, we think, maintaining populations. Discharge through open gates needs to be provided during winter to allow migrations of females. And whilst I haven't spoken about it too much, the other thing that's important is fishway operation during spring and summer for the upstream migration of juveniles. Now I'll jump forward to our next species, which is the anadromous pouched lamprey. So it's got an opposite diadromous life history to congolli. Now these guys hang around in the marine environment as adults, where they roll around parasitising large fishes, sharks and even whales. They use this sucking mouth part here to attach to hosts, and then these rasping teeth to make a wound, and then they feed on the body fluids. So they actually roll around the ocean like an ill vampire thing for a couple of years before they migrate upstream into freshwater habitats to spawn. Now the spawning run actually takes about a year, in which time the adults don't feed at all, and after spawning they actually kick the bucket. Now the ammocetes or juveniles live in freshwater habitats in sediments as little filter feeding worm-like critters for about 4 years, and they eventually metamorphose into small versions of adults and migrate downstream. Now interestingly, based on historical data, the distribution of this fish in the Murray is actually really quite broad. There's records of lampreys as far upstream as Narrandera, Yarrawonga and the Upper Goulburn, but there's very little recent data. And what else do we know about pouched lamprey? And one really important thing is that they've got highly developed sensory systems, and particularly a sense of smell. And indeed, smell plays a really important role in migration and breeding behaviour. Now, this is actually a nostril of the lamprey, would you believe? And the juveniles actually produce these specific juvenile pheromones, and the adults can actually detect these in water in extremely minute amounts. And they actually use them to guide migration. So what essentially happens is that adults are sensing water that's flowing from upstream, and if they do detect the presence of juveniles, then that suggests to the adults that, yes, habitats upstream are indeed suitable for spawning and rearing these young, so that's the direction they'll take on their migration. So we're pretty interested in lamprey, and we were actually undertaking some trapping just to look at abundances of these fish at the barrages in winter 2015. Fortunately, we caught over 50 of these guys, and we implanted them with pit tags. Now, it was mentioned before, I think by Zeb, that the fishways on the main channel weirs have pit readers, so we hoped we'd be able to look at the movements of these fish. After tagging in July, August 2015, 25 individuals were detected at lock 1 by August, 270 odd k's upstream, 18 at lock 4 by September, 6 at lock 9 by October, and actually one fish made all the way to Mildura at lock 11, about 900 k's upstream by December. So this was the first data on movement of lamprey in the basin, other than anecdotal evidence from a long time ago, that we've ever collected, and it showed that these long distance migrations are indeed still happening in the basin, which is really neat. And it also really begged the question, that year in 2015, there was actually quite a bit of flow at the barrages that originated from the mid-Murray and from some of the tributaries, including the Goulburn. And so it really begged the question about these juvenile pheromones and adult migration, and whether flow and adult migration was being influenced by that. So we still had all these questions about lamprey migration. We're even more interested about it. So we've chosen to replicate that study, but basically to find a resolution using acoustic telemetry. And we're doing that right now. So in collaboration with Vic and New South Wales researchers, we've established an array of receivers all the way from the Murray barrages to Yarrawonga, including some of the significant tributaries as well. And thus far this winter, we've tagged 38 adult congolli with, adult pouch lamprey with acoustic tags. And thus far, a few of them have actually passed through the lakes and are moving up into the river on their upstream migration. So we look forward to getting some more results. So to summarise, we've learned a lot about diadromous fishes in the last decade or so, and unsurprisingly, they've got species-specific flow requirements, given that they've got different migration seasons and they interact with flow a bit differently, and they also have these different spatial scales of life history. You know, congolli operate over tens to hundreds of kilometres, whereas lamprey potentially operate over thousands of kilometres. And it really highlights that both catchment and local scale management of environmental water and also infrastructure is really important for these guys. When I'm talking about catchment scale management of environmental water to support diadromous fishes, I suppose I'm mostly talking about lamprey, and it appears, although we do need to do more research on this, but providing flow that maintains its integrity from nursery habitats through to the ocean during winter might be critical for these guys. And it's probably important to minimise re-regulation. It seems like a natural process in rivers, but as was presented earlier by someone else yesterday, flow to South Australia is often re-regulated through Lake Victoria, which might result in the loss of these cues. Winter flows are also really important, and they're part of the hydrograph that's missing now and doesn't get talked about a lot. However, there's a few upstream catchments that are now starting to do it a bit, and it really presents an opportunity for multi-site watering, which is obviously an economical use of environmental water and should benefit lamprey and many other species. Lastly, this local scale operation of the barrages has a huge influence on the population and dynamics of these species. Unlike upstream with run of the river sort of weirs and fishways, environmental water is actually often needed to provide discharge out from the barrages and even to operate the fishways. And this is critically important for these guys. And we now know the seasons and how we have to operate the barrages to really support them. And that's quite simply fishway operation and open gates with discharge during winter, and at a minimum fishway operation during spring and summer for upstream migrations of congolli. Now, just to finish off, I think these diadromous fishes are really quite unique, and they're very interesting and unusual and probably unfamiliar to a lot of people. Whilst to some people they might not have a huge amount of value, but from a management perspective, they really encapsulate a lot of the issues that face management, particularly the notions of connectivity and the idea of maintaining flow from source to sea. And because of that, I reckon they're a great vehicle for educating people about these sorts of issues. So, thank you very much.